Welcome to Tea Time, conscious conversation and organic tea. Thank you guys for joining us. I'm Harmony Frenterhouse, your host, and my guest today is Tracy Kelly Williams. Tracy is a wonderful friend of mine, a soul sister, and she has been on an amazing journey this past year, and she's also embarking on new adventures in connecting with manifestation and connecting with coaching and soul progress of others. She just created a Facebook group that I joined, and I'm really happy that I did. And that is where she helps with soul empowerment coaching for empaths. And she helps women experiencing career burnout, panic attacks, and creating an anxiety-free life. And I know that we could all use that because there is so much stress that we're being inundated with environmentally, spiritually, and physically, mentally, all the stuff, and it adds up. And I'm really, you know, thankful that you are doing what you're doing. I know you're also a nurse and that you've also been doing a new certification as well. And I'm excited for that. So many things you've been doing along with being a mother, and a wonderful mother you are. I'm so thankful know you and to have you as a guest today on this show. If I forgot anything, let me know. Thank you so much for joining me.
No, thank you so much. I really appreciate your kind words and our friendship, and I am excited to be here for sure.
Cheers. Yay.
Cheers.
Exactly. Cheers. Today we're sipping on some Earl Grey tea, and I have mine a little bit sweetened with some pinch of stevia and creamed up with some coconut cream. And I didn't used to like any sweetener or cream in my Earl Grey tea, but I've kind of started to enjoy it with the coconut cream and the stevia, just because it feels healthier and it feels like it's amplifying the benefits instead of creating an antagonistic relationship. It's actually like a synergistic relationship. So I really enjoy this. It's like a caffeine substitute. It has an amount of caffeine in it, but it's a good coffee substitute. And it's really quite delicious. If you only brew it for, 1 to 5 minutes, do not brew it for over that. It gets really bitter. But it's got a lot of great health benefits, and it really helps with clarifying the mind as well. And when you're dealing with anxiety, you're dealing with burnout, that kind of stuff, this can be a great companion. Of course, with anything, we want to make sure that we use in moderation and, don't develop an addiction to the caffeine within it, but it can be a good companion. I would love to hear some of the reasons why you chose to sip on Earl Grey tea today.
Well, I hadn't had it for a while. That was one. but I love Earl Grey, and I love, and for me, sometimes the caffeine actually helps me have focus. So I will, I've already had coffee today. I don't want to overdo it with the coffee. Because that makes it worse, right? But the Earl Grey kind of has a calming effect for me too. So with the focus and the calming, and just in the chat beforehand on the video, we had severe thunderstorms. I'm actually in central Texas at the moment, and there was a tornado warning just like an hour ago. So I also have anxiety disorder, which is why I love to help other people manage anxiety, and I'm an empath, and I needed something calming. So that's why I chose the Earl Grey today.
I love it. Yeah, it really does help with, calming the nerves and sparking the mind to be able to function a little bit more easily. And when you're already dealing with anxiety, adding, being on a video creates more anxiety. So it's a good thing to use a mental stimulant and, something that can anchor you into your body a little bit more so that you can be more present. And I love that. So, it's definitely a good choice for me. I'm glad I had it on hand, and I'm glad that you chose that, because I haven't sipped on any for a long time either. Usually been doing my herbal teas, a lot of nettle and stuff like that for the spring, because it's that springtime, a lot of tips and good things like that for the raspberry tips and the fir tips and different things like that that are coming up at this time of the year. So I really kind of love to get into a little bit of something that's not in my habits and just kind of jump out of what I would normally go to. So I love that as well. It helps to really get out of default mode. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
be more mindful. Even just like just changing up your tea can really change up the way that you're approaching your day. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's actually one of the techniques for manifesting what you want is changing up something in your day.
I love that.
So
that goes right into what we're, go ahead.
It is.
Yeah. That goes right into
that's what I was going to say. It goes right into what we were planning.
I love it. So yeah, we are going to talk all about manifestation and empowerment.
There's a delay on this end a little bit, just so you know, I'm having a hard time.
Okay. Yeah. We
hearing you
both kind of live out in the middle of nowhere right now. So hopefully we can get good connection. So, yeah. So we are going to talk about manifestation and empowerment and moving through anxiety and getting burnout, things like that, and actually helping us to amplify and empower ourselves and others more today. So I'm excited. That's something I really love to talk about. And I know that you do too. You had a workshop, online workshop that was really powerful. And it was about anxiety and burnout and all of the tools that we can use to help us to transcend those feelings and anchor in our true higher selves and anchor in empowerment and manifestation. And that's why I wanted you to come on the show again. You are also a return guest on the show.
I am.
One of my earlier guests. And that was such a fun conversation. I highly suggest everybody go and check out that video. And I'll put a little link in the comments if I get a chance. And definitely one of my favorite guests and one of my favorite friends as well.
Oh, thank you.
Cheers.
Yes, cheers. Thank you.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So in manifestation, there is so much to cover, but I really, you know, want to get into the nitty gritty on like how it is, how we are approaching our life and how we see through a certain lens that actually aligns us to the relationship of manifestation that we have. So I know that you are really into all of that. So I'd love to hear some of your perspectives on how it has changed your life to see through a different lens. And I'd love to hear what you have to say about that.
Yeah, absolutely. So in my experience, I was looking for a way to create the life that I wanted. And for me, a lot of this focused around not just creating that and sort of trying to manifest this thing, but I had to do a lot of healing first. And so a lot of this work is deep inner work too. So this is going through evaluating what your values and beliefs are and then figuring out whether or not they're actually yours.
Yes.
Because we're taught when we come into this life by whoever it is that is around us, that their truth is going to be our truth. And that's not the truth, right? We know that by experience, but you know, we continue to live that until we've had some experience that makes us shift our perspective. And so this is actually being aware. I had to go through having the awareness of going looking for those things. So what really were my values? What did I value? What did I believe about myself? And what did I believe about the world? And what did I have to shift or change in order to get where I wanted to go? Right now we're RV living. Okay. So we're RV living by choice. So we are traveling around the country. We actually manifested this collectively here.
So awesome.
So I'll talk about the process of that a little bit. So in having gone through a lot of this process, it's been a lot of years. I've been working on this for a long time in bits and pieces. And then really about 3 years ago, I started really pushing forward and doing the work, doing Akashic Records work, doing the clearing, affirmations and things like that to get myself aligned. And it was an inspired thought. Okay, what if we sell the house and we go travel? Because we know we're not really sure we want to be here and we know what we'd like to do. And I know that I don't want to be working for a hospital as a nurse for the rest of my life. You know, I've already done that for 23 years. I don't want to continue to do that. So what I do want is to be able to help people the way that I know how to help people by doing this coaching, sort of coaching, teaching and things like that. So what if we did that? Is that plausible? Well, yes. And see, another thing that you have to think about when you're working on something for manifestation and being aligned is the people that are going to go with you. Mm-hmm. So when you look at that, if you've got, say you've got teenagers and all of a sudden you're thinking, oh my gosh, it's so inspired, we're going to move to North Carolina and we live in California. Mm-hmm. And your teenagers are in public school and they're, you know, a sophomore and junior and they don't want to leave their friends. And all of a sudden your whole house is in an uproar, right? So how can you make it happen that you get the freedom to go to North Carolina where you will feel inspired and love to live and not make your family go nuts, right? So you kind of have to look at all of that, all of those parts and pieces, who's around you, who's going to help you manifest it. And whether or not that's also right for them. And so right. We decided to collectively that this was right for us. And we started taking action steps to make it happen. Started making repairs to the house, started getting myself set up to be able to work remotely, thinking I was going to keep the nursing job for a while. Affirmations, crystal grids, more healing work, working on health too, because it all goes together. This is very holistic. It's every aspect of your life. It's not just the spiritual aspect, but it's the mindset. It's the body, it's everything, it's environment, mm-hmm. all of it, when you're trying to manifest something. And we were able to, I think really we started talking about it in February, and we were in, we had sold the house and moved into the RV by Thanksgiving weekend of 2021. Mm-hmm. So February of 2021 to Thanksgiving weekend of 2021. And now I'm not going to say that there weren't challenges, because mm-hmm. there are, right? But when you're looking at manifesting something and you're popping up with roadblocks, it doesn't mean that you give up. You just figure out how to make it more aligned so you can get past the roadblock.
Yes.
That was a lot of talking for a minute.
No, that's so, it's all so pertinent. And I really agree with what you said, you know, like all of it really. But then there was that one part where you're talking about, you know, like considering who else is going to be on that ride with you, who's going to be playing the game with you. And that's why, you know, they would say, you know, don't tell anyone your wish or it won't come true. It's because it's not that you shouldn't tell anyone your wish. It's that you need to be selective, because some people inadvertently, subconsciously may have resistance to this desire, this manifestation that's being awoken and birthed, that they literally will stomp it, not even knowing it sometimes. And, or they, mm-hmm. you know, their resistance will create some kind of tethering to where the getting from point A to point B, it doesn't look like what you thought it may look like. And it can actually cause a lot of uproar within, like you said, the teenagers that maybe didn't want to move away from their, where they've been raised, or, you know, all those different things. Like maybe you have a partner that, you know, doesn't feel like it's time for them to move that away, or it doesn't not time for them to, you know, start that next chapter in their life, no matter what that is. If there's resistance there, then that may create some kind of rift between the two people in the relationship, so that the one can continue to advance even if the other one doesn't. So yeah, it's very important to be considerate and mindful on how it's going to be affecting the people that you are going on the ride with, you know, because that is a key part of what I've understood in my manifestations. And, you know, some of the reasons why I only tell certain people certain things about what I'm doing, you know.
Yeah. And there's kind of, as you're talking, I'm thinking about too, you know, a couple other things that go along with that is one that, you know, when we are moving ourselves forward into something that we really want, that's a heart ask want, and we're shifting our vibration, other people around us that we're very close to are either going to shift up with us or they're not.
Yeah.
And so we have to be prepared for that to happen. It's okay to let go of those people. It doesn't mean that we don't still love them or that they can't be in our lives, but we may not be able to have the level of intimacy in a relationship that way, you know, over a long term because of the shift. But also to be clearing ourselves and clearing cords and be aware of our energy. Mm-hmm. Because as you said, there will be that tethering. You mentioned the attachment and the tethering, even when they're unconscious, you know, they might not be conscious of what we're doing, but their unconsciousness or their energetic system feels things changing.
Yeah.
And you'll actually see that a lot with when you're doing release work or releasing cords for relationships, old relationships. I will warn clients that the partner that you're releasing, even though it was 5 years ago, we just released something energetically, don't be surprised if they message you, because they're going to feel it. And they know, they just, it's, they don't, they're not conscious of it. They don't understand it, but they're like, oh, hey, I haven't talked to that person in a while. I'm going to go ahead and message them and see what's going on. It's okay to not have, you know, in that situation, okay to not have contact or anything like that, but just know that things like that are going to happen. And it's part of the evolving and growing, because as we shift ourselves and shift those relationships, it opens us up for new relationships to come in, for new doors to open, for us to have a different perspective on what comes next after the thing that we're already trying to present ourselves with or trying to make happen.
Right.
Trying to make that's, manifest.
That's so important to, you know, be true to thyself, not to shift your frequency just because other people may not align, but also to be considerate in those who you are very connected to. Like if you're a mother, you know, you need to definitely consider how it will affect your children. If you had like 10 children and you're trying to move into the motorhome and go on an adventure, it's not going to be the same as if you're, you know, and like if they were all teenagers, as opposed to, you know, you have a young child who is ready for adventure and doesn't take up very much space and all of that. It's definitely going to be considerations. You're going to have to make viable decisions for these other people. And so it's important when you are a mother, when you are a guardian of other people, that there is considerations being made for other people. And I think that usually when we're in the most alignment with the true divine and the true destiny that we are, you know, supposed to be living out, we already understand that, that it all flows together and that people will assimilate with us if that's where we're meant to be. And that's one of the biggest keys of manifestation, I think, is to release and surrender, like to put it out there, plant the seeds, but then to know that the rain and the sun will shine, and to have that faith and that surrender to know that, like, you know, hey, Great Spirit, I want to be guided to where I'm supposed to be specific on what you need and your needs and the necessities that you need, and then put it out there, you know, release it, and know that it may not look like what you thought it was going to look like when you originally imagined it. Getting from point A to B could be totally different. And a lot of people visualize money, like I need this amount of money before I can get from point A to point B, or a thing that symbolizes money or a construct outside of themselves. However, when we step into that actual alignment and that frequency, like I am this, I already have this abundance, then it magnetizes it to us. And therefore, often it takes the middleman out, that money middleman, like he goes out the window. Yeah. And somebody just is like, here's a car, or here, you know, like you just want a car, yeah. Or, you know, like I have this basket of mushrooms that I just harvested and I want to share them with you. And it's just like the amount of abundance that we are able to receive when we drop the limitations on ourselves on like how it needs to look to get there. That's when all the magic comes in, because we're allowing the universe to show us that it provides, and that there's always a way, and there's always a flow, ebb and flow when it's supposed to be there for us. And as long as we connect with that, that's when it really unfolds for us.
Yeah, exactly. So you know, being very specific with what it is that we want, making sure that we're taking action steps towards it that are in alignment, and then letting it go.
Yeah.
Letting creator, letting the universe, letting the energy take care of that, and not really worrying so much about what it looks like.
Yeah.
However, I'm going to tell you some other little tricks to manifestation. So, Akashic Records soul level information, there's actually a couple different ways, or a couple different types of people and manifestors. Some people are very goal focused, and so they've got the goal, they know what the goal is, and they have a hard time figuring out how they're going to get from here to the goal. Mm-hmm. And there's other people that are really focused on the journey. Mm-hmm. And so they're not focused on necessarily what the journey is or how the journey looks, but having the experience of the journey, knowing eventually they'll get to the goal.
Right.
So the people that are very goal oriented sometimes need assistance walking it backwards, trying to figure out how, what action steps they're going to need to take to make it happen.
Yeah.
But, and then there's people that can do things.
Those that dance in the middle.
Yes, exactly. And then there's people that can do things consistently, right? They can do the same thing exactly the same way every time. They've got their ritual that they do when they want to manifest something and it works. Mm-hmm. And then they give it to somebody else and that other person is like, well, it worked for me once, but the other six times I tried it, it didn't, and I'm failing and I don't know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
It's because they're a variable person. They can't do the same thing the same way every single time.
each moment is different, and each instance has a different connection to how our subconscious aligns with mm-hmm. that experience.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. There's so much richness in how we approach the play of manifestation, you know, and how we connect to abundance and to poverty, to the relationship between the dualistic aspects of our place in within that scale of poverty and abundance. And I think most of us have been conditioned in a way throughout society to see a class system and see ourselves on that lower scale of the class system, because in each moment we literally could be anywhere on that scale, depending on our resources that are out there in the world and our abilities and all of the different aspects, all those different factors that factor into our ability to manifest something in that moment, our subconscious belief of our ability, you know? So like when I go out in the Pacific Northwest where I live, and I mean, literally I see abundance everywhere. I don't see dollar bills. I just see abundance. You know, I see all of the amazing things growing out there for me to harvest, and the water that's here, the fresh air, all of the things that I connect with on a level that I often didn't see when I was young. You know, when I would place myself on a scale of poverty, I would just go out there going, oh, I can't do this and I can't do that. And there's limitations here and there's limitations there because of this dollar sign. And when I realized, look, it doesn't have to be about that, that's when the whole world opened up and enriched for me. And I was able to see all of the abundance and then manifest it or magnetize it back into my reality. And it was just like, keeps growing and snowballing. It's like it continues as long as I keep a open mindset and a mind of gratitude and of abundance and sharing to others. Mm-hmm. One of the sayings I always loved about, you know, my heritage and my ancestors is they would talk about, you're truly abundant if you are the, I don't remember what the saying is. It was abundance isn't measured by how much you have, it's how much you share, how much you can give. Mm-hmm. And it's so true, because when we give, we are magnetizing ourselves to the reality in which we have enough and there is a lot and abundance, and we mm-hmm. can constantly be the fountain that's flowing it out. But when we get into a place of like wanting to hoard or not share, or, you know, of course there's a good place of boundaries and that's, you know, another discussion, but, you know, when you want to hoard things and not be giving, it creates a block for that flow. It's almost like, you know, mm-hmm. the glass, once it's full, it just keeps overflowing. It can't really mm-hmm. contain and flow, you know. You need to have a balance of pouring the water out in order to keep replenishing. And I mean, we are constantly on an overflow default program of in society, and we're not even realizing, like, look, there's so much abundance, it's literally overflowing, but because we're not giving, it's not flowing mm-hmm. through us. And that's the key, is like to find that balance and not be like reckless. You know, when you have children, you don't give away every single thing that you have in order to not be able to take care of them. You know, you don't give everybody all of your food and not feed your children, of course. Like, you know, it's a balance. But there's also, there's a very important key to that concept, that when we give, it allows the universe to keep giving to us, you know, and it's a huge key.
Yeah, because it's the feeling of the vibration, right? So we're sharing, we have abundance, and we're sharing that abundance with someone else. And where if we were not sharing, or if we were in a state of, oh my gosh, paycheck to paycheck, I can only get this much, that's a very different energy. So even if you're trying to share from that energy, it's almost like it's a resistant share. And that's, you know, where it's coming. You don't have to share your paycheck, but I'm sure there's something that you've got, you know, make cookies and share them with your neighbor. That's how you know how you're going to get out of that energy of that. And that's it's a very tough energy to be in. We've been taught, a lot of us, that paycheck to paycheck is the way to live. And it's the only option for us when we've got certain jobs or certain situations. And it's not true. We just have to figure out what's going to work for us to help us shift the mindset so that we can pull in that level of abundance and expanding it beyond just the paycheck. The abundance isn't just the paycheck. It's everything in our experience. It's the vehicle that we drive. It's that somebody loaned us or gave us $20 for gas. It's that, you know, somebody next door had extra strawberries. We walked down the street last summer, and a couple of houses down, somebody had these blooming raspberry bushes, and we got, you know, like so many raspberries out of that. I mean, there's a lot more abundance than what we normally think of, like you were saying, you know, walking out into the Pacific Northwest, into the area where you're in, and seeing everything that you can, that's like right there to eat,
Or even one time we were at the Mount Shasta Headwater Spring, and somebody had left like three boxes of persimmons and was like, take all you want, free persimmons. We're like, oh my gosh, we were just talking about persimmons like 2 days ago. This is amazing. And so like we were talking about wanting persimmons, and then literally they manifested out of nowhere and where we never thought that they could have been. And one important thing you were talking about is action steps. And I think that that's like a key part of all of this, but there is like that miraculous like action step that is just happening within our subconscious of allowing the ability, the possibilities of magic to occur, you know? And that's one of the things that have been shut down in our subconscious for years and for even lifetimes, is that ability to bring forth the magic. And that is one of those action steps I have been doing within my mind, is when I see doubts and limitations, I just breathe that in and say, that's not me. Like you were saying, you know, what is really you? What are these anxiety and these thoughts? Are they really us? You know, or no, they are a collective program, and we get to acknowledge, breathe it in, breathe it out, feel it as a human, acknowledge it, and then move through it, and then connect to the next step. You know, connect to like who we really are, connect to thought resonance that actually illustrates what we are wanting to bring into the world. So, you know, it's easy to go into like the place of doubt. I'm not worth it. It can be hard. I'm going to have to work, and all these places of things that may shut down those possibilities for this manifestation. So if we find ourselves in that place, to just breathe it in and breathe it out and move through it and connect into like, what is it that is actually going to bring us to that manifestation? Because I guarantee that those thoughts are not the resonant thought that's going to be in alignment to the reality in which you actually have these things. And so it's important to use it as a catalyst in order to move into that trajectory timeline, you know? And I really believe that it is about aligning with the timelines in which these things are already happening. And that's how we can convince our subconscious that we are already there. It's because there is these timelines that it's actually happening. It just depends on what decisions we make, depends on which branch we go down. And it's ultimately going to bring us to this connection. And I think that the action steps, just like, you know, the actual manifestation, they can look different than what we think they're actually looking like. They can look like us actually diving deep within ourselves, within our collective programming, and to step into that authentic reality, step into who we truly are, and, you know, acknowledging those thoughts as a default program we get to rewrite. So that's one of the coolest things, is as we do this work, we are actually helping these negative, or, you know, negatively charged thought forms to not continuously be run on the collective program computer. And, you know, so right. for our youth, as we connect into our strength and our empowerment and know that, like, these self-defeating programs are not truly our authentic self, and do this work, literally it is changing the template for our children and for the next generations to come. And even actually goes back into time, because time is only linear from the third dimension. It is literally like instantaneous. It goes to our parents and our grandparents, and it literally heals in all directions ourself and our DNA. And so we are able to step into our next journey with much more power, much more connection and authenticity to our relationship, to our reality, than we ever were in our previous, you know, footsteps. And that's the most exciting part about all this, is because as we do the work, these programs, these scenarios don't keep looping themselves in our life and right. showing up in different relationships over and over. They're literally opening new doors for new possibilities for us to step into. And it's just so exciting. And that's why I love the work that you're doing.
Well, thank you. Yes, absolutely. These, like everything that you said. So yes, we're you know, only here in the 3D is it linear, where we've got a past, present, and future. As soon as we're outside of that 3D container, everything's happening simultaneously. There is no time. And so therefore, even though we're not conscious of it, we are living multiple lifetimes and on multiple timelines all at the same time. And so what you were speaking, what I recall you speaking to before about, okay, well, this is already happening somewhere else. It is. But here in this 3D timeline, we can absolutely heal it. The more that we are able to break out of the old patterns, make new choices, heal past life stuff. We can even heal past life trauma that helps heal our children, because they don't have to continue that. They're not going to carry that because we healed it, right? Yeah. So, and those are some of the other pieces to manifestation, right? So you talked about getting stopped up with the self-doubt and everything, and having to push past that, and that is absolutely true. We also have a biological concept, or our biology of us says anytime we're trying to do something new, stop, because you're gonna die. Your body tells you that. Yeah. It's part of our biological DNA programming, because if you did something new and different and it was scary and risky, well, your body doesn't know that we live here now where you can walk to the grocery store and buy whatever food you want. I mean, we're relatively safe in this country, relatively safe in many areas of this country. And doing something risky does not mean that we're going to die. It's not the same type of risk. So there's having to really kind of dive into, okay, where is the doubt coming from? Is it a fear from within me? Is it my body that's telling me that? And then to push past it, because the minute you take the step, that action step to push past it, it all dissolves.
It does.
And that's one of the things I love about this, is that there's some really interesting myths out there about, well, if it's not from the community, if it doesn't flow, then it's not right. And then you should just change it. Oh, no, that's actually when we're probably right on it, because it's risky and because it's aligned. And then we're getting pushed back, not just from ourselves, but sometimes the universe says, how bad do you want it? You need to be just this much more in alignment to get it. You have to figure out how to shift it there. it's like the, you know, it's got to snap into place.
Yeah, it really does. And it's like when we experience, you know, so much trauma and certain things that do ingrain into us, not only in this lifetime, but in past lifetimes, it can create those barriers where it fogs up the lenses. And we do literally go, if I walk to the store, I could die. Because I actually had that feeling. Yeah. Like, it's funny that you use that analogy, because when I lived in Everett, I actually had, I talk about this in my book. I was attacked by a serial rapist and almost abducted. And I actually had some severe PTSD from that for years until I decided to face it. And I could not literally walk one block away from my house to the store without going, somebody could hurt me, somebody could kill me, somebody could abduct me, and this is not safe. And so for years, I literally would not do that. And it took me one day of just saying, I'm done with being in these chains. I'm done with being locked into these scenarios that aren't even, that could be, but I'm more aligning to these realities if I stay in this mindset. So I can actually realign my realities and be safe and go in the daytime or go, you know, have some kind of protection or whatever it was that empowered me to move through that discomfort, move through that feeling of, you know, limitation, and actually say, okay, my ego is here to protect me and has protected me for, you know, thousands of years in the DNA genetic timeline of how the ego works. However, I am going to move through that and put it aside and go, look, I can be protected. I am protected. I know that even though this thing happened, I actually chose it and I did it to put him behind bars. I did it to empower myself, all these other millions of reasons why I chose that to be part of my timeline. And I know that I was protected in that. And I know that I'm continued to be protected. And once we realize that and it dawns on us, it's like, oh, it doesn't matter. All that goes out the door, all the fear, all the limitations, it just fades away. And the anxiety that I felt was able to go with that. And I still had a little bit, you know, of like, oh, this is weird newness of apprehension. Like, oh, am I going to make it there? But once I made it there and then I made it home, it rewrote the story for me to where I was able to do that in the future. And so that is like a great illustration on what we were speaking about before, on how it actually does shift once you push yourself through the discomfort, and then succeed in what you were wanting. I mean, even if that is as simple as getting to the grocery store and back safely, that like actually doing that, I mean, like literally I would get in the car and drive a block and a half away. I'm not joking. I was so scared. And then I was able to walk all sorts of places after that. And I was able to have a freedom that you can't pay for. You know, it's a freedom that if I wouldn't have gifted that to myself years ago, who knows where I would be now, you know? Because it literally does align to these circumstances of how we're going to experience it by the perceptions that we preconceive into certain experiences, you know, of our lives.
Yeah. And that's, you know, any of these, even if we're talking about past life traumas that come up, the experiences for each one of us that is having an experience is very real. There's no, somebody else's trauma isn't actually trauma because it wasn't like my experience. It's very real. It's visceral, right? Everybody's trauma is real. However it is they perceived it, it doesn't matter what happened to them. There's no judgment on that, or whether it was past life or present life. So I find that one of the things that works well for the people that I work with is doing like you did, maybe not all at once in a day, but creating new safe experiences to rewire their brain to know that the thing is safe.
Yeah.
And often it's around relationships and talking to people. It's around asking for what we need. It has a lot to do about us getting our needs met, especially moms. And as women, we don't always ask for what we need because we're doing for everyone else. And then there's lots of fear of judgment, even, you know, around other things. And it's perceived judgment. I've had to learn that. That's actually a me thing. I had a lot of perceived judgment. I thought that people were judging me for everything, but I was really judging myself. And so the more I practiced just being out there and letting go of that and being myself, I realized that people are busy doing their own thing. They're busy in their own heads, and they're not even thinking about what I said, you know, 3 days ago that I've been worrying about for like the entire time, because I thought maybe they thought it was weird, you know? Yeah. It's just having to recreate the experience for ourselves so that we can have our bodies have now a visceral experiences of something different.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, it seemed like it was this miraculous moment where I just got up the bravery, but it did, like you mm-hmm. said, it takes like a working up to like each time mm-hmm. I told myself, no, I'm not going to walk. I did something small where I was like, well, maybe there's a possibility, or maybe I don't need to be so afraid. And so each time it did take a while of working through this, you know, years to where, you know, there was that one moment where I was like, this time I'm going to do it. You know, and it's, so it seems like sometimes it's just this miraculous day that happens. And sometimes that's what it looks like to us. But really, it is that, you know, shedding the onion layers mm-hmm. of our ego and our, right. our protective walls to allow the blessings in and allow the true core to shine. And when we all operate from that true space of unconditional love, it is abundance, it is true flow, and we're constantly allowing the energies to move through us instead of getting stagnant. And I believe that a lot of my anxiety, a lot of that, you know, what you said about, you know, the judgment, like I was there, you know, I was like, oh, we can't do this because the neighbors will judge us, we can't do that because the neighbors, the people in the store will judge us, you know. And one day it just, you know, falls away, and it was like, oh, I don't have to worry about what anyone else mm-hmm. thinks. I know I'm doing a good job, and if someone wants to come and question me, I can show them that, you know. And that helps to shed a lot of the anxiety and the fear that is based around that cycle of self-attack, you know. It's like the more we are in judgment of ourselves, the more we're worried about what other people thinking, the more we're worried about ourselves, the more we're worried about what other people thinking. And it just kind of like amplifies and amplifies. But if we take a deep breath and know that like, there's a reason why we're different, there's a reason why we're doing it different. And it is because maybe what has worked for generations is not necessarily serving this new reality that we're moving into. It worked before, doesn't mean it's going to work continuously. You know, it's like a machine. It needs to be maintenance. It needs to be updated. It needs to be continuously recalibrated. And, you know, that's what we're doing. And if we look at ourselves with that lens, we can just see so much forgiveness and see so much mm-hmm. growth and so much beauty that we are holding. And we can utilize those tools in further pushing us to more empowerment and moving out of that anxiety, moving through the places of discomfort and into our true aligned, you know, timeline, our true most empowered self in that moment. And of course, in the future, we may look back and go, oh, wow, I had so much to learn. But that's perfect, because that shows us that we have progressed. That shows us that we are continuously evolving and continuously moving through these energies with a fluent approach, you know. And that's one of the keys to this. You know, I believe that a lot of diseases, whether they're emotional, mental, physical, spiritual, they come from stagnant energy. And when we become the flow, when we let that flow, no matter what the energy is, if we don't let it get stuck within us and get stagnated within us, then it can flow out and it doesn't leave an imbalance, you know. And if I would have only understood a lot of that much sooner, I could have lived a much healthier life until then. But, you know, once we do realize that, it does help us to align to the next embodiment that we are becoming. Because, you know, they say every 7 years, we literally have a whole new cellular makeup. And that is a beautiful right. thing. If we think about that, then, you know, what we're doing now is literally building blocks of who we are going to be. So, you know, the more we connect, the more we're going to be connected in the future. And that goes to people outside of us and to go within, you know, connect within and connect within new community, build within and build without. And it helps. It's that as above, so below, or the only way out is in, right. you know, and that is, and yeah. that is the best way to really approach all this, is because we are constantly evolving. So it's a wonderful journey we're on.
Yeah, it sure is. I've appreciated it so much, all of the learning, and I know I still have so much more to learn. And you know, I learn something new from everybody I meet, right? And there's no stopping learning. I don't think you ever stop learning, right?
Yeah, that's the coolest part about it, is because, you know, the more open you become, the more you realize you don't know. You know, it's like there is constantly flowing and there's so much mystery, but there is these really cool patterns that we can see throughout time unfolding for us, that if we just look and we observe, it's all there, and we can kind of see how we can work through this reality and how to approach certain things if we observe certain patterns and connect in with how nature works and how growth and evolution and how spiritual progression with an exponential spiral and how, you know, how it all unfolds. We can see that and then see our growth so far and then move into a space of release and surrender, because we know that it's all going to be okay. It's all going to flow in the way that it's supposed to teach us the lessons that we need to learn. So, you know, if we can really breathe that in those moments of anxiety, that can really be a huge tool to moving into the next space of creating and moving through those feelings.
Yeah. One of my favorite affirmations is everything in divine timing.
Yes. So yes. Yes.
I now activate divine timing in my life and everywhere in my life. And that's probably a paraphrase from Camille Moritz.
I love it.
Who, I met her in Alaska. Gosh, Michael and I have been married for about 12 years, and I met her the year before that. So 11 years. And she started teaching me affirmations and how to write them. And now she's got a book. And so I teach a lot out of that book. Really great affirmations, but divine timing. And that one is very calming, because then I know if I'm affirming and I'm stating to the universe that everything is happening to me and for me in divine timing, then I am divinely guided and divinely aligned in all of those things that are happening.
Yes. Yes. So well said. It reminds me of Gandalf, you know, from Lord of the Rings, how he says a true wizard's never late. And I remind that of people when they come, they're like, I'm so sorry. I'm like, no, you're perfect timing. Mm-hmm. You know, true wizards never late. And that is basically, you know, divine timing. It's understanding that if you would have been there 5 minutes, if you would have left 5 minutes earlier, you may not have gotten there at all, you know, right. And there is a divine timing, and we can't push ourselves. We can't try to pull open a bud to make it be a flower, or you will destroy the whole process. So understanding that the bud is there for a reason, and all that energy that it's holding is a potential for what is about to unfold. And that is the coolest part about who we are. We are literally plants. We are literally part of nature. And we absorb sunlight. We need water. We need nutrients. And even emotional love, like plants, it's been proven that they grow better when they're given a nourishment emotionally, mentally, and not just physically. And, you know, the spiritual aspect of who we are and how we connect to one another and to ourselves is ultimately how dictates how that flower is going to unfold, you know? So just embrace the process and know that, yes, it's good to have milestones. It's good to have markers and goals, and to know like, yes, I'm going to be a flower one day, but to enjoy that process of being the bud, of being the sprout, you know, and, you know, the caterpillar doesn't think about becoming the butterfly. The caterpillar just does. It just eats the green leaves and, you know, the pie and the apples and the pears and the blueberries of the story, right?
Yeah.
Gets a big old stomach ache.
Yeah.
And then it realizes, I need to make a cocoon, and it's just making the cocoon and just does its thing. And then all of a sudden it's a soupy mess and it turns into a butterfly. And it's like, whoa. Now look at me. And it's not looking back, worrying about who it was, having regrets and guilt. It's not doing any of that. And it's not worried about what's going to happen in the future. It's just going to fly. And I think that if we remember we are a template of nature, and we just can connect to like, okay, how is this like a seed, or how is this like a butterfly? We can really, in a caterpillar butterfly relationship, we can really tap in to something greater than the anxiety that was once a default program that, you know, I've felt run through me, and I know that you have, and probably almost all humans, all Americans especially, have some kind of anxiety that they have felt in their life, and some sort of, you know, stress overload, whether that's environmental, physical, mental, spiritual, and emotional. And it's part of being a human. And that's the cool part about it, is like, we don't have to have regret and be like, oh, this anxiety thing, we need to hide it and put it in a box and not talk about it. It's like, no, we need to talk about this. We need to bring it out there, clean out the closet, make a big old mess, and then put it back in where we can honor it, you know, and maybe release some of it. Maybe it no longer serves us, and, you know, just honoring it in all different ways. And so that's the cool thing about what we're doing, is we're just being human. We're just having this amazing experience, and we don't have to have that guilt. We can just be. And in that, it empowers so much. And I just absolutely can't convey that enough.
Yeah. We're living in the now, not in the past. All we have is now.
Yeah. That zero point energy.
Whatever it is that we did yesterday, whatever mistake it was we made, it's okay, because we can make a new choice now.
Yeah. And it showed us what didn't work. You know,
Exactly.
Sometimes we need to be shown what doesn't work, so we can really appreciate what does. And, you know, that's been a huge gift for me the past, you know, several months, even years, is every time something comes up that doesn't work, I'm able to see through a lens that like, oh, wow, look at how that served me. Look at how I'm able to learn from that. And in that, I don't hold the same like worry and guilt and anxiety that I used to, of like, if I messed up, and in my mind, how other people are viewing me, I'm just like, well, apparently they needed that to view me in this vulnerable state so that they could grow themselves. And that is our most, like, one of our biggest gifts, is to be honest and vulnerable with one another, to let each other know that even though we're strong and empowered and we're like amazing fighters, we are sweet little innocent children that have been hurt, or were, you know, the elderly warrior that needs to be loved after battle, or, you know, all those different aspects of ourselves that are within that we can honor, and we can, you know, show one another like, look, you have this too, and it's okay. And I have this, and we're all together on this, you know, team Earth in humanity, you know, that's like one of the biggest things that I can convey, is we're all human. We're all on this path as humans. And there is a underlying template of lessons that we get to learn, and beauty that we get to experience, hardship that we get to experience to complete our amazing journey here. And that's like, you know, it's all in the richness of duality, and then moving through that into a perception of embracing duality, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, so much goodness. I would love to hear any closing thoughts before we go into words of wisdom, and just anything you feel like we didn't cover that you wanted to touch on.
Well, I'm not sure that we talked about a lot of things.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, no, I think that you know, just going over manifestation again, it's, you know, figuring out who you are and living in your truth. The more that you're able to live in your truth and know that it's your truth and it doesn't belong to anybody else. So this is looking at the shoulds. You don't have, make sure that the career that you're doing, you don't have because you should do the career because somebody told you to, or because you should make that amount of money, or because you should have the house with the white picket fence if you never wanted that. You know, looking at all those things. I'm doing, you know, big generalizations here because this is, you know, just as examples, but looking at all of those things and then living and standing in your truth. We are sovereign beings, and we can create our own reality. We absolutely do create our own reality. We co-create with each other and we co-create with the universe,
Yes.
whatever it is that we're trying to manifest and whatever action it is we're taking, whether it's an aligned action or not, we're still co-creating. So I think that was just my end.
I love that because it is really, you know, how you approach the whole dance that allows you to enjoy it or to fall down. So, you know, it is a dance. Life is a dance. And when we step into that role as the dancer, you can allow yourself the freedom to just celebrate all of the victories, even if they seem like mistakes. You know, like what was a mistake in the past, you know, helped catalyze us into this new creation of who we are now. Right. So it's like, love those mistakes, love those lessons, love all of it and celebrate it. Celebrate the small victories, because if we have our mind on this huge goal way down the thing and we're not going, look what I just did. Yay. Oh, I'm celebrating. Like we forget that it's supposed to be fun, you know? So like maybe, you know, for me, I wrote a book, but I celebrated the first chapter. I celebrated the fact that I sat down on the computer and actually did it. But then my book got erased and I was like, oh, I'm not going to do this. And then I celebrated again. Right. So it's like, you know, we got to celebrate those small, small victories. And, you know, even if it was never published, I was able to celebrate along the way. And I think that helped me to align to the reality in which it became a, you know, actual tangible item, which I can hold. Even if it sat in the computer forever, I would have still been, satisfied, but at the same time, it helps me to move beyond the limitations in which I had and step into my authentic self. And, you know, it's just like a fingerprint. We all have an individual one. Even identical twins have a different fingerprint. We all have a different voice print. So we have an imprint to be made on this life, under this world, that's individualized, that only we know. And just because, you know, I think one of the other things I wanted to say, what you said is, you know, if like the reality of what it should look like isn't aligned to what you think your reality of your dreams, then, you know, don't worry about the white picket fence. You know, if your dreams look like a houseboat on a lake, do it.
Yeah.
Don't let reality and society and the norm and the box keep you contained. Like it's not there. It's just there so that you can see what it looks like to have a box. You don't need to be in it. You can, you know, like you can be the circle. And that's one of the most beautiful things that we can do is shapeshift and transform our lead into gold. And that is the true process of alchemy. And whether that is physicality or, you know, spiritual, emotional and mental transformation and transcendence is essentially one of the reasons why I think that we came and incarnated on this earth at this time. At least for me, that's what one of the main reasons I'm here. And so I love this discussion. We could go on for a long time about all this stuff because it's so fascinating. But I know we're on limited time and I would love to hear any words of wisdom that you have that you'd like to share to close with.
Sure. I think I would, you know, one thing that I would like to say about creating what it is that you want, what you want your life to look like is don't give up. There is always a way to make it happen. It's just figuring it out what it's going to look like for you.
Yes.
Don't give up. Don't let it go. Just, it might need to be reimagined a little bit. It might need to be tweaked a little bit. How you're going to get there might not look the same, but there's always a way, whether you've got issues with anxiety, with burnout, with panic, with trauma, unresolved trauma, there's still always a way to get yourself where you want to go.
Yes. Where there's a will, there's a way. Humans have a will, a divine will, a spark that is individualized, and we make our own choices. And, you know, if you feel like there is something more, there is a way. And I can't express that more than you just did right there in that moment. It's just so beautiful. You have definitely spilled the tea all over the place today. The truth is out. I absolutely enjoy this conversation. I absolutely adore you and all the amazing work that you're doing for this world and for yourself, for your daughter, for your family, for our community. Oh, you're just such an amazing person. And I would love to hear any ways that we can contact you. If you want to drop in some of your projects that you're working on, your website, any of that stuff, I would love to hear. How do we get a hold of you, Tracy?
Oh, sure. Well, first, thank you so much for having me on. I love you too, honey. on Instagram, you can find me at Ascended. It's Ascended, Hearts Studio. And then on Facebook, I have a Facebook group. You can actually find me as Tracy Kelly Williams. Feel free to friend me. In parentheses, it will say McGondal, and it is same hair color and everything approximately. So you'll see a picture. And then the group is Empath Empowerment Tips for Managing, I may not say managing, but it's Burnout, Anxiety, Panic, and Energetic Alignment. So right there, I'm doing trainings. Spirit guides.
Yeah, the team.
We're doing trainings in there right now about every week. And then I'm going to be running a challenge. So that will be a free challenge that people can participate in as well in the group.
That is so exciting. And I know that sometimes you launch little free classes on like Akashic Records and all sorts of really cool things like that. So stay tuned to what Tracy is doing and connect with her. Get a coaching session or one of these amazing connecting empowerment. What would you call it? Empowerment session.
We can always get on a call. I'd love to help whoever it is figure out an action plan. We do that so you get a chance to experience what coaching is like, and then we go from there.
Heck yeah, definitely highly recommended, and helps support our community. That's how we do it. If you want to connect with me, you can find me on Facebook under Harmony Lorraine Fronter House, Harmony Fronter House, Wildcraft Wellness, and all of the other ones that you can find that I do have lots of Facebook pages. And we also have a YouTube under Wildcraft Wellness, and you can subscribe for free on the YouTube and hit the notifications gear to be updated on all of our newest videos. Please give it a big thumbs up if you like this video. It helps share the algorithms, and also share it on social media with your friends and family, and get this message out, help the movement move, and help, anyone that out there that you know that could use these tools to, better enrich their life and empower each other. And that's really the message that we are bringing across today. Thank you for sharing a cup of conscious conversation with us, and so much love. Cheers.
Thank you. Love to you too. Cheers.
I am excited to share with you my new book, Birthing a New Paradigm. It's a transformational book that helps you to unlock your greatest potential. Are you interested in health and wealth? Well, this is the book for you. This is a part autobiographical, part instruction manual on how to embrace your journey here, learn the lessons, transform and transmute, to take the lead and turn it into gold, birthing a new paradigm. Get your copy today. You can find it on Amazon. You can also find it on Etsy. My Etsy page, you will get an inscribed copy. So order from me, get an inscribed copy on Etsy under Wildcraft Wellness, or you can find it on Amazon and share with your friends. Blessings, everyone.